Hi and welcome to our little birthday party today. Well, it's not exactly, but roughly 2 years since we released the Trackbox Passive. Together with Racesalt CTO Nikias Klohr, we today want to look back on those 2 years and how the product developed since its release, why it's important to keep developing such a product, and how the future of the Trackbox Passive could look like. Nikias, what are your feelings if you look back 2 years to the release of the Trackbox Passive?
So first of all, I would say we're really proud of the product. In hindsight, it was perfect timing because we released it right when COVID hit. And then with all the permanent installations going on, wouldn't have been possible without the passive trackbox. So was quite interesting. Obviously, I would have liked a better start in different circumstances, but for the circumstances, it was pretty interesting.
Let's take a closer look at the aspect of product changes. And let's take the solar mode as an example, which was released after the official trackbox release and was the idea of a customer, right?
Yes, correct. So it was quite interesting because when we started using the trackboxes, or our customers started using the trackboxes on permanent installations, it was quite obvious that one of the issues is that how do you power them? And one key fact of the passive trackbox is that it consumes quite little power compared to traditional timing systems. And therefore, for the first time actually ever, it was possible to do a true solar-based installation with it. And it was not on our list of requirements when we designed the product. But quite soon after releasing it, one of our customers asked us whether it would be possible to somehow power it with solar. And we looked into the design and found that, yes, it's not perfect, but it can be done with the existing hardware. And basically, we rolled out the solar feature with a firmware change.
So this is the way how you work in hardware development. You get true ideas of customers and see if you can implement them into an existing product which was already released, right?
Yeah. It happens quite often. So typically, on the day that we release something, I always say only half of the work is done. So we don't release things before we actually are sure that it's a good product. Typically, at the day that we release something, we believe that this is the best we can do, and it's gone through a lot of testing, and we truly believe that there is nothing more that can be improved. But then I would say in 99% of the cases, people come up with new ideas or find things going on in the real world out there on all the events, which then lead to further improvements, be it in firmware or in hardware. And this is typical, something that we're working on all the time, is taking all the feedback and all the ideas and trying to integrate them into the product and improve the product even after it's been sold.
And even having the hardware development people, manpower to do so. What else would you say were important changes, improvements, and also fixes, of course, of the product?
Yeah, for the passive trackbox, there's quite a list. Maybe for the ones who got the boxes early, they may remember some of the changes. So for example, we had to change the power supply, and then there was a change because of noise issues with other RF equipment disturbing the boxes, and there was a battery change, and the housing had to be changed a little bit for improved waterproofness. All kinds of changes. It's a long list. But there's one change which may be a little bit interesting, which at the end also led to the magnets change that I think we're going to talk about. And that was the robustness against external disturbances, where we had we found after a year or so, we found an issue that in special circumstances the box can be disturbed by other RF equipment. And it was a special application, but we wanted to improve that. And by that, we changed the design of the circuitry to make it more robust. And with that, we added the problem with the magnets.
Yeah, we need to talk about that, because actually for me as a marketing manager, that's what you want to avoid, is to send out a letter to customers with small magnets and say they have to use some force to actually replace something on the hardware of the product. So, but the intention was before, as you mentioned, to make a a change inside, which then affected the magnets outside, right?
Yeah, it's a very good example of, you know, these products are kind of complex, and sometimes it's difficult to foresee what's going to happen. And we always try to test everything, but sometimes things like this can happen. And not you only as a marketing manager, also I am in my role of a CTO. I don't want to have people having to open up our boxes and do some repairs on them. That's definitely not what we want to do. But in this case, I have to explain what happened is that on one of the events we had a strong issue with external disturbances, really in a way where we said, okay, we need to change something in the design for this. And for that, we actually redesigned the circuitry, the filter circuitry on the PCB, which sits close to the magnets holding the case together when you have it in the flat position. And unfortunately, in all our testing of the new circuitry, we always tested it in the sitting on the ground position or in a hanging down position, but never in the flat up position. And everything looked fine. And then I would say 3 months later, we got first reports that people were having troubles. And actually it took us quite some while to figure out what was going on, because the box was, you know, originally tested in that position. So was really kind of a riddle to figure out what's going on. And eventually we found out that in the flat position, the magnets holding the box together is so strong and affecting the new circuitry, filter circuitry, that was intended to be a good change, in a way that was very negative. And that's why we had to send out the metal plates to replace the inner magnets, so that you can now have benefits of having the new circuitry and even use it in the flat position.
So, but I mean, the key thing here is to actually that you have your developers and yourself look into this problem and improve it, right?
Yeah. It's actually, you know, in development, we have a priority list, and it's our highest priority to look at things that go wrong in the real world on events. So it's even, it's a higher priority than developing new stuff. I mean, we are continuously working and developing new things, but once in a while something comes in, you know, when something goes wrong on an event, where we scratch our head and think, what's going on here? Or a pattern appears where we say, okay, something really may be wrong here. Most of the cases, we can fix things like that with firmware changes, and you won't even notice, especially for the trackbox, because it does automatic firmware upgrades. But sometimes, like in this case, hopefully very rare cases, we need to do a hardware change.
Let's take a look ahead. What plans do you have for the Trackbox passive? I mean, of course, keep improving it, but let's say looking forward 4 years, which role in timing in the race result product family will it have?
Yeah, I think it already has for timers who use it right now. Actually, just 2 weeks ago, I talked to an old friend, a good timer, who said for many of his events, especially trail runs and mountain biking, he couldn't imagine not working with passive track boxes anymore. So I think it already changed the way people work a lot for people who adapted it and adopted it to their way of doing events. It will never replace a full timing system at the start or finish line, but especially in trail running, where it's also a problem to get the equipment up on the mountain, it really changed the life of our timers. And for the future, I think that it will continue to replace or may enable new timing locations at places where currently you would just not put a timing system. So it will maybe make it possible to have even more data along the track, especially mountain sports, everything in the mountains. And currently with the next release, there's one new thing coming up. That's again something that we found is actually at the moment in permanent installations in winter sports, and we have an issue that if the box is too cold for too long, the batteries can't be charged because they can't be charged when they're cold. And the problem is then if the if you have a power failure, your battery may not be charged when you need it. Yeah? Or when the power comes back, it can't be charged because it's cold. And that's why with the next version of it, probably coming mid this year, we will have a battery heater inside, where if the box has power and can't charge the battery because it's too cold, it will first heat up the battery and then charge it.
So a lot of room for improvement for you engineers still. And for us, I think it's maybe a good occasion to do a little birthday party for this trackbox. Thank you, Nikias. Thank you for watching, and see you next time. Bye.
See you next time.